love that set the captives free. The same love that opened eyes to see. He's calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide. The same God that was crucified is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name.
Great, I'm now on. Okay, so a warm welcome to our service this morning. I haven't said that many times, you know what I mean? Actually on a Sunday morning. So it sounds even weirder every time I do it. But a really warm welcome to our service this morning. A really warm welcome if you're watching this a little bit later at home and things. Hi to you guys. We're starting a new series today. We're looking at a series over the summer called Who Do You Think You Are? Who we are in Christ. And we're going to be kicking that off today with I Am a New Creation. And we'll just be unpacking that a little bit later. But let me pray and just invite God to be with us this morning. Lord God, I thank you for your goodness, grace, mercy, which is poured into our lives. Lord, help us, Lord, as we come, Lord, before you this morning to sing, to praise you, to worship you, to pray, to unpack your word, all of these things, Lord, in order that we might better enjoy our relationship with you. Fill us, Lord, with your spirit. Help us, Lord, as we seek to follow you. Lord, you are a gracious and wonderful God, and we just praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Forgot to say, you can sing now, but we'd prefer if you kept your masks on. So what kind of state masks we'll be in by the end is anyone's kind of business. But yeah, you can sing, and I encourage you to sing. We will still be taking our last song outside. We're primarily doing that for Margaret, who turns up every Sunday, and we're not primarily doing it for her, but you know what I mean. She probably won't turn up this morning now, I've said that. But it's been really great to just be able to unmask and really kind of get into our worship together. Okay, I'm going to hand over to John.
Thank you, Dave. So yes, we are able to sing out more, still wearing masks, but we're going to sing this song, I thought it most appropriate. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise. Shall we stand together?
Triumph of the triumph of the triumph.
This week, the heat that can be produced. And we sing about this within this song. But this says, you put the stars in outer space. You pop the freckles on my face. And all the fish that swim and all the birds that fly were made from your incredible imagination. And the song goes, Creator God, we're singing to the Creator God of all the world. Creator God, we celebrate you. We celebrate you. Who is there like you? And who else would give their life for me, even suffering in my place. It reminds you, look forward to the stage, you see that cross. Remind us of what Jesus has done for us.
This is 2 Corinthians 5, verses 14 to 17. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come.
We're now going to pray.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this privilege that you've given us to be able to pray to you, to bring our needs and to bring our thanks to you, our loving Father. We thank you this week for the lifting of some of the restrictions with regard to COVID. But we're aware of the changing numbers as they fluctuate, as more cases go up and then the cases come down. And so we pray for wisdom, tolerance, and sensitivity to the situation for those that have to make the decisions. Help them not to be proud and stick to their guns, but to recognise when things might need to change for the benefit of our society. We also thank you that these changes mean that we can now meet and sing as we've been doing. And we thank you for that. We thank you as we move forward as well with this new series, Exploring Our Identity in Christ, with us being new creations, temples, conquerors, part of a holy priesthood, and adopted. We thank you and pray that you will be with those of the people that are planning and preparing for these. We pray also for the way we evolve as a church, following on from the way we've been meeting in the last 12 months. We ask that you'll be with those that have the responsibilities to consider what we do now, what we did then, and what we did during COVID, and the way forward. So we pray for those areas.
Father, we pray for all those we know who are facing health challenges at the moment. Father, we pray especially for Jade, whom we heard about earlier in the week, and we ask that you will heal her body and remove the effects of coronavirus, and that her newborn baby will grow and thrive. We pray for the whole family, the wider family, that they will experience your love and the support of praying friends at this time. Father, we pray for others we know who are unwell, perhaps those who are facing ongoing treatment or awaiting investigations or results. We draw near to them, we pray, and give them your peace. And in a few moments' silence now, let us just lift those that we know of to the Lord in prayer.
So we pray for our mission partners, wherever they may be. We pray for the work that they've had to evolve, sometimes unable to continue in the way in which they were doing because of the restrictions placed upon them by health and by governments. We thank you for those that have been able to be vaccinated where they are. We ask that you will continue to protect them and their families. And we pray that as the disease moves away, that as restrictions are eased, as lockdowns are eased, they will be able to take on again some of the work for you that has been doing beforehand. And we do pray for this future in the same way that we as a church are needing to evaluate and work out our way forward. For some of these people will recognise they've started doing different things. They've started to rethink places that they've been to, people that they've worked with have changed. And so we ask that through these coming months, as they are able to, you will give them guidance as to what things to restart, what things to continue doing, and what things from before and what they're doing now that they should really stop and concentrate on other things. We do thank you for all of our mission partners around the world. Be with them and guide them.
And Lord, we lift to you the various Cluedo events taking place over the summer. But we thank you for this opportunity to do things differently. And we just pray now that these events will provide opportunities to share the good news of Jesus with whole families. We long to see people turn to you. And we thank you that we can come to you with confidence because we've seen you answer prayer in the past. And we pray that you will provide all that is needed for these events to take place. Father, for the weather, for safety, good conversations, open hearts. And we pray particularly for the event coming up on Thursday. Father, just pray that that will be a blessing to all those who attend. And we just lift that to you now. And Father, I pray now that you will bless the rest of our time together. Help us to have listening ears to what you want to say to us. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, guys. It was good to hear from Andy, wasn't it? That was a bit of a surprise for the Hoyleses and things. I asked Andy at the beginning of the week if he'd send in a video of the Bible reading. He sent me a video of it in the Message. He sent me a video of it in the NASB. He sent me a video of it in the NTL version. And I finally got the NIV, which is the one that I used. And things, but it was really, really, really good to hear from him. I want us to think a little bit, and hopefully I'm going to get a bit of from these guys here, because I need you to kind of work with me a bit here. We're going to think about God as creator, and I need a PowerPoint to go up in a minute, okay? And I'm going to ask a few little questions, and if you get a question right, because we're still in the midst of things, and we've got to be a bit careful. If you get a question right, Mike Bradley gets a prize. You don't know what the prize is yet. Okay, Mike Bradley gets a prize. These are all kind of creepy, crawly kind of questions and things like that. Now he's beginning to think what his prize might be. And you can deliver his prize to him in a minute, but you've got to get this right. So if we can have the first PowerPoint up first. Can you tell me what this is? Right, next one. What's that? No, cricket. It's not a caterpillar. What is it? It's not a cricket, actually.
Cricket.
What? Grasshopper. It's a grasshopper, okay? Fun fact, in many countries, grasshoppers are delicacies. Okay? Fun fact. And I happen to have some here. Do you think you could see if Mike would like one? Well, I don't think you. I'm not sure I can. I didn't like it. Yeah, okay. Mummy doesn't mind if you try one. But Mike's going to show you how to eat it first. Straight hand. I'm going to come to the front. Well, film you having a go. You don't want it? Oh, okay. Okay. Okay.
Go on, Remy.
Take one.
I want to give one to my mum.
You want to give one to your mum? I'm sure your mum would love that. There we go. Okay. So, fun fact. Hang on a sec.
Can I have one?
I'll let you have one in a minute. All right, we're going to go through. If you just focus just a bit. So, in many countries, grasshoppers are delicacies.
Good.
Where are grasshoppers mentioned in the Bible? Anyone know? Where? So when the spies go into Canaan, they say that the people make us look like grasshoppers because they're so big and things like that. Okay, so you did very well. If you identify the next one. Next one up. What's that?
Worm.
Worms, you were right. Fun fact. Okay, if human beings were worms, Angus Nightingale would be working 5 times more hard. Why is that? What? They have 5 hearts. Now, you probably wouldn't be working 5 times hard because their hearts are a lot simpler, I guess, than human beings. And a few of them are quite redundant. You know what I mean? You could chop them and get rid of bits and pieces of them and things like that. But yeah, fun fact. Can anyone think of where worms are mentioned in the Bible?
Under mud.
Anyone think? In fact, we looked at them in Acts.
Mud.
Who's that?
Mud.
Yeah, Herod refuses to praise God, an angel strikes him down and worms eat him. You're glad you came, aren't you? Yes. Okay. Fun for that. Next one. What's that?
Spider.
You're good at this, aren't you? I'm going to let you have some of these afterwards. In fact, I'm insisting that you take them away with you and give them to your dad. Okay? Okay. Yeah, yeah. Fun fact. Yeah. Spiders have how many eyes?
Two.
No.
Three. Four.
They have eight eyes. And they also have eight legs. So you can remember eyes and legs, okay? So they have eight eyes, eight legs. Do you know what colour their blood is?
Red.
No.
Black.
No.
Green. Green.
No.
Blue.
They're royal.
Blue.
Blue. They have, spiders have blue blood. That makes you want to go and find a spider, doesn't it? And kind of just have a look. But apparently spiders have blue blood. And another fact, apparently you are never more than 10 feet away from a spider. Off you go looking. Okay? You're never more than five feet away from a spider. They live on every continent except
Antarctica.
Oh, except Antarctica, yeah. And do you know where they're mentioned in the Bible?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, go on then.
They spin a web over David to hide him when Saul's looking for him.
That wasn't the bit I was going for, but that's interesting. They also mentioned in Isaiah 59 where it talks about evil and the spider's web, it spins it and things like that. But okay. Okay. Cool. Right. Next one.
Caterpillar.
Caterpillar. And what do you think caterpillars, how many legs have caterpillars got?
None?
They've got lots of legs. They're humongous loads of legs. Do you know, I think sometimes we're a bit like, this is the bit now, guys. We're a bit like caterpillars before we become Christians. After we become a Christian in the Bible, it says we're a new creation. That's what it says in the Bible. So caterpillars are a bit like us before we've become Christians. But after we've become Christians, we become
a butterfly.
And it's interesting, the Bible doesn't use this kind of analogy. Weirdly, the Bible, if it wants to use an analogy of a new creation, it uses a seed which has to be planted in the ground. It dies, the Bible says, and then it comes to kind of new life. But let's get back to our passage again, that one before us. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone. The new is here. Let's all say that together. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. I'm just going to unpack this passage a little bit. But while I'm doing that, James, just going to share. We're going to be doing a little bit of stuff over on the table over there. And James just going to tell us what we're doing. Or what you're doing.
I'll tell you.
Well, you know what I mean. Okay. What is that?
Good, I'm glad you can see what it is.
You get a chance to make a butterfly over on the table. So if you'd like to go and make a butterfly, crack on over there now. And that would be really, really good. Excellent. Oh, you can have those if you want, Sayers. As I say, Dav wasn't there to eat my trout on Wednesday, but he can have the creepy crawlies. And thank you for cooperating, Mike. Well, I didn't ask for his permission beforehand. He's a good man. Okay, I knew he'd be up for it. I am a new creation. What does that mean? What does that mean? Therefore, if any man, if any woman, child, whatever, be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Has anyone here ever watched? Do you mind if I get a glass of water? Has anyone here ever watched Extreme Makeover? Put your hands up if you've watched Extreme Makeover. Few people, not many. Okay. Basically, there's a British version and there's an American version. Who's watched the American version? Okay. In the British version of Extreme Makeover, a team comes in, there's a house. They do a bit of work, you know, they pull out a kitchen, put a new kitchen in and all this kind of stuff. Knock down an old conservatory, put in a new conservatory, do up a garden, build an extension, all of these kind of things. They do a kind of, they basically tidy up the house, okay, the British version. In the American version, they knock the house down, okay? So in the American version, and it's kind of interesting because a lot of the people don't know that they're going to be this extreme, but in the American version, they knock the house down. They get rid of the whole house and they build a new house. Okay, so British version tidies it up a bit. Conservatory, extra room, kitchen. American version obliterates the house and builds a new one. I want to say that I think the American version is nearer to the point of when it comes to what it means to be a new creation. Every Christian, the Bible tells us, is a new creation, an extreme makeover. We're not just a makeover job. It's not just bits of us that have been changed. It's not just bits of us that have been given a bit of a cleanup. It's an extreme thing. And we see this in baptism. You know, at the beginning of kind of in the Christian walk, if you like, in baptism, we talk about a person dying and coming back to life, in that new life. That new creation. We're completely new creations. In one of his letters to the church in Corinthians, we've been reading this, Paul talks about what it means to be a new creation and its implications now. We are new creations. Now we live in Christ. Now we enjoy some of the benefits that that new creation brings now. But why do we need it? Why do we need to be that new creation? Well, again, if we look in Genesis, if we look in the first two chapters of the book of Genesis, man is serving God in the garden. He's having fellowship with him. He's having a great time. By the third chapter, it all goes pear-shaped. Rather than enjoying his work, work becomes a drudgery. Rather than running to God in order to have fellowship with him, he's running away from God. He's trying to hide. They're trying to hide. Well, what's happened? The Bible tells us that sin has entered the world. Sin has come in and sin has changed us so that we can no longer enjoy that relationship with God. Sin is anything that misses the mark, anything outside of the perfect will of God. Literally, that word sin means to miss the mark. And sin changes everything. It changes our relationship with God. It changes our relationship with each other. But there is good news. There is good news because of what Jesus has done. In Christ, we can change. 2 Corinthians 5:17. I'm going to repeat this a lot because I think it needs to kind of sink in. Therefore, if any man, woman, child is in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away. All things become new. That word Paul uses for creation, it's the same word that in other places of the Bible describe God creating the world. And just like God created the world in the beginning, so he recreates those who are in Christ. He brings them into that relationship. Now the trouble is, when we encounter a truth like that, we encounter problems in our own self. Sometimes, you know, we believe we can't change. Will I ever become good at DIY? Alison. You see, you know, can we change? Can we change? And we believe that we can't become something new. But if God has the power, if God has the ability to create in the beginning, he also has the power and the ability to recreate if he so desires. And he does. And he does it through Christ. He does it through Christ from the inside out. This newness is not produced through New Year's resolutions. I'm rubbish at New Year's resolutions. It's not something that we can accomplish through our own willpower. Jesus said, you know, we can clean up the outside of the cup, but the inside is still dirty. This newness has to occur inside of us through the power of Jesus Christ. We need a new me. Therefore, if any man, woman, or child is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all things are new. What does it mean to be in Christ? What did Jesus do for us? Well, he died for us. He's God's Son. And, you know, this is all stuff that you know and hear, but sometimes we need to kind of really re-grasp it again and walk with it and run with it. You know, we can say it so glibly. Jesus came to earth, saved me of my sins. Boom. There's a few verses a bit later on from this passage in 2 Corinthians 5. It's in 21. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And there's a big word in this called imputation. And what does imputation mean? It's an accounting term. A few people's eyes lit up then. It's an accounting term. It means taking something from one account and placing it in another. Suppose you co-sign for me on a debt. What does that mean? It means that you're making yourself responsible for my debt, and that if I can't pay the debt, sufficient funds are going to be there in my account, or they're going to be transferred from your account into my account. In a sense, my debt is transferred into your account. Your assets are transferred into mine. This is what God did for us through Jesus. This is what we continually walk in. This is what we continually understand that Jesus has done for us, so that we might enjoy that relationship with him. And all of this means surrendering to Christ, acknowledging that there's nothing that we can do except through Jesus, asking him to fill us with his Holy Spirit in order that we might live a life pleasing to him. You know, it's simple, and yet it's incredibly deep. And surrender is not something that comes easily to us. Paul writes, if any man, woman, or child be in Christ, they're a new creation. And that if any, implies that some are and some aren't. And I think these are things and these are themes that we've constantly got to be pushing into as Christians. You know, we leave things behind. We lose some of the identity that we have in Christ. We kind of done the cross bit and walked on, forgetting that we're supposed to take it up and walk with it. You know, there are people who don't have a desire to live for God. You know, there are people who've never been made a new creation in Christ. Maybe they've gone and said some words. Maybe they've been baptized. But nothing new has taken place in their heart. They're like the cup that Jesus spoke of. You know, where the outside has been washed, but not the inside. They don't have a new heart. They don't have a new desire. The Holy Spirit does not live inside them. And therefore they lack the ability to please God. Their Christianity is like a New Year's resolution we all make on January and forget by January the 31st. We've got to push into these things. We've got to hold on to these things. The new me isn't a one-off thing. It's a process. And we've almost got to push into it. I think I had a friend, and I always remember, he told me he did a spiritual MOT, and he did it every year. And it was almost like a recommitting himself to Christ every year. You know, looking at those kind of things, those areas of his life which needed to be looked at, making sure that he hadn't left anything behind that he should have been taking with him, asking God to fill him with his Holy Spirit in every activity that he was about. And I want to give us a bit of an opportunity to become a new me, if you like, in 2021. I want to give you an opportunity to experience him, Jesus, so that we make sense of what that means, that new creation in Christ. Now, how do we do that? Well, we acknowledge our need for Christ. And that's something that we constantly do as Christians. We believe that Jesus, God's Son, died on the cross for our sins. That's something that we remind ourselves when we take communion. We come to him in faith and receive his forgiveness. And we can do that again and again and again. And we ask that he fill us with his Holy Spirit and enable us to receive all that God has for us. Therefore, if any man, woman, or child is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Can I ask you to stand? And I just want this to be a bit of a simple acknowledgement of who Jesus is and a bit of a rededication time, in a sense, as we push into all that God has for us. I'm going to give you a bit of time. You know, as we go through that kind of process that I talked to you about, you know, we are sinners, we're in need of salvation. And I just ask you in the quiet of your own heart to acknowledge that and to reach out to God again. Because we need to do it again and again and again. We're saved, we're being saved, we will be saved. We work out our salvation in fear and trembling. Just in the quiet of your own heart, bring those things before God that you know separate you from him, and ask him to come in and save you from them. That second thing, believe that Jesus, God's Son, died on the cross for your sins. This is where we take all those things that separate us from God. We take them to the cross. And then we're asked to carry the cross. It's a daily reminder. It's a daily reminder of our need of him. Oh, Lord God, I just thank you for your love poured out for us on that cross. Thank you that it is sufficient. It doesn't lack anything. Thank you that it deals with even the blackest of things. Oh Lord, thank you that you've pulled us from darkness into your most precious light. And then we come to him in faith, in belief that he wants to forgive us, that we don't have to hold on to these things, that we can lay them down and walk forward with him. That he is able and he is willing to forgive. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness for each one of us. Lord God, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, to receive all that you have for us. Therefore, if any man, woman, child is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed. Behold, all things have become new. Fill us, Lord, with your Spirit. And help us, Lord, walk in the truth of that, that we are new creations in you, in Jesus, because of what you've done. Praise you and thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. And stay standing while we sing our last song.
Let's just reflect and sing that word of praise, Hosanna.
I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
I see a generation,
I see a generation rising up to take their place. Selfless faith, selfless faith.
I see a near revival.
I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees. We're on our knees.
Okay, if you do have your newsletters on your phones, you can see the words. If not, hopefully many of you'll know it. It's that song which says in its chorus, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire, flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy, send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, the light of your love is shining.
Shine on me, shine on me.
shadows into your veins. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this lamp with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Glory to flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light.
As we gaze on your kingly brightness,
gaze on your kingly bright, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirror near, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory.
That you've done so much, Lord, to draw us into a relationship with you. Lord, you didn't wait for us to try and claw our way to you. You came, Lord, to earth. You lived amongst people. You loved. You cared. You went to the cross. You died. You rose again. You dealt with that most fundamental of our problems, which separates us from a relationship with God, Lord, our sin. You dealt with it on the cross, and we just praise you and thank you, Lord, for that. Fill us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Work in our lives, Lord, that we might just live lives which show the incredible work that you've done in our lives. Fill us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, to understand what it means to be in Christ, a new creation. Shine, Lord, in our lives, I pray. Fill us, Lord, with your Spirit. Help us, Lord, to serve you and to serve this community in which you've placed us. Bless us, Lord, and encourage us that we might be a blessing and encouragement. Lord, we ask that in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Take care, guys.
Same love that set the captives free. The same love that opened eyes to see. He's calling us all by name. You are calling by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified, is calling us all by name.